Okay, good evening and welcome to the regular city council meeting. This is Tuesday, February 2nd, 2016. If I can remind everyone to silence your cell phones. And Madam Clerk, can we have roll call, please?
Councilmember Mosby.
Present.
Councilmember Starbuck.
Present.
Councilmember Holmdahl.
Here.
Mayor Pro Tem Victor Vega.
Here.
Mayor Bob Lingle.
Here. Okay, if you'll please rise, remove your caps for the invocation by our city manager.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you for this day you've given us. Thank you for this opportunity to gather. And I just pray for your wisdom to be upon this council as they prepare to deliberate the issues of the day. And pray for your continued blessing over this community and its people. We ask all this name in your name. Amen.
Amen. Please remain standing and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay. Okay, I'm having a presentation, I guess. I'm going to select three names out of a hat. This will be for a free dinner at Wild West Pizza for the father-daughter dance precipitants.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. As you mentioned, the owner, my name is Joanne Plummer, Recreation Manager with the City of Lompoc. And as the mayor mentioned, Wild West Pizza has generously donated a dinner for a little girl and her daughter a little girl and her father who have registered for the upcoming father-daughter dance. The dance is this Friday, Saturday, and Sunday at the Anderson Recreation Center. And we have been sold out on Friday and Saturday for over a week, and Sunday only had 30 spaces as of 5 o'clock tonight. So Super Bowl's not holding back some of these dads. So if Mayor, on our Friday bag, if you could reach in.
I hope it's me.
I hope it's not, you're not a daughter.
Oh.
And the winner for Friday is Mallory Branham. And Saturday is Natalia Jimenez. Sunday. And Sunday is Camilla Adams. So congratulations to our winners, and thank you, Mr. Mayor, for your help, and a big thank you to Wild West Pizza.
All right. Okay, and now we are going to have city plaques presented to the outgoing Economic Development Committee members. Let's see, maybe you can come forward. Mr. Steve Pepe, Ms. Janelle Osborne, Mr. Rick Rance, Mr. Robert Manning, and Ms. Debbie McComb.
And Mr. Mayor, members of council, if I could just say a few words before I give you the plaques to present to our committee members that are here this evening. Teresa Gallivan, Economic Development Director, Assistant City Manager, and I'd just like to share with you that we're here to recognize these five members tonight that the mayor just named. Three of them could be with us this evening. Unfortunately, two of them couldn't be here this evening, but the accolades go out to them wherever they are this evening. And these members have completed 4 years of volunteer service to the City of Lompoc. And as volunteers, they've helped increase economic vitality in Lompoc. And I'm going to just go through a quick list of things that can't possibly capture everything that's been accomplished in 4 years. But I just want to go through some of the highlights of things that have helped our community and they've given their time to do. They've been advocates for the scoreboard to be installed at the Aquatic Center, the J and Ball Fields to be renovated, and both led to more tournament play and visitors to Lompoc. They've been advocates for the change in zoning in Old Town that led to offices being allowed on the first floor of buildings and increased occupancy in Old Town. They've been advocates for improving the sidewalks in front of the Lilly Building up to Walnut with the installation of pavers. This led to a commitment from the owners of the Lilly Building to paint their building, and then this led to other property owners making improvements to their property as well in Old Town. They've created the Economic Vitality Award to honor businesses that make investments in improving their business and the community. They've written with staff the request for qualifications for the 82 acres next to Allen Hancock College. They researched and recommended a program for council to develop an ad hoc committee to meet regularly with the Chumash regarding matters that we have in common. They've developed with staff an economic development strategic plan, and they've updated it twice. They've given 9 progress reports to council. They've written 39 columns that have been published in the Lompoc Record promoting economic development in Lompoc. They've given feedback to council and the Planning Commission through the general plan update process. They've researched and made recommendations to the Planning Commission and staff regarding parking requirements at wineries that were successfully updated. They've advocated to be one of the first communities in the area to develop an economic development element in the general plan, and they worked with staff to write that element. They've been part of the organizing committee that put on the first forum to celebrate and support regional agriculture, growing possibilities. This was held at the Dick DeWeese, bringing in regional businesses and partners, as well as dignitaries such as Karen Ross, the Secretary of California Department of Food and Agriculture. These folks came to Lompoc, they experienced our beautiful conference facility, and they learned about what's new in our community. They've participated in property tours and meet and greets with potential business partners when appropriate. They've advocated for incentive programs and supported the creation of the utility rebate program. They've participated in regional economic development efforts, including the County Workforce Investment Board, Northern Santa Barbara County Economic Alliance, and the Tri-County Broadband Consortium. They've supported annual job and resource fairs. They've been advocates to the Oversight Board release of the lien on the theater that led to the Lompoc Theater Project Committee becoming the property owner that will renovate the theater. They supported the development of the Bike Skills Park. They supported the work on the Criterion. They were advocates for workforce development offices in Lompoc, and through a partnership with the school district, successfully opened services at El Camino Adult School. They've spoken at numerous events and before community groups promoting economic development in Lompoc. And at council's request, they reviewed development service fees and made suggestions. They promoted the Public Safety Training Center opening and held a workshop for businesses so that they would benefit from the visitors coming to town to get training. They supported the formation of the Tourism Business Improvement District known as Explore Lompoc. They participated in meetings with staff and supported the transit transfer station in Old Town. With the support, they put on an with staff support, they put on an economic vitality forum, among many other activities they've been involved in. And for all this and more, I want to thank each of you for your valuable work and all that you've done to help improve economic development in Lompoc. And really, I'd like council, mayor and council to please present the plaques that we have for them for completing their 4 years of service. I'll hand them to you.
So Ms. Osborne, Ms. Janelle Osborne.
There we go.
There you are, and congratulations.
Thank you. Hi.
Ms. Debbie McComb. And Mr. Robert Manning. Sure.
Can we get a picture with you over here from the council? Maria, will you take the picture?
Can you get the entire council in, Maria?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Okay, where are we? here now.
City manager report.
We have Samantha, I think I'm going to mess up your name, but let me try this. Kaiserstadt? All right.
Yeah.
We're going to have Samantha Kaiserstadt. She's representative from Vandenberg Air Force Base, Community Engagement Section, and she's going to give us a presentation on the efforts to manage the snowy plover. I heard this presentation a couple months ago at the Community Advisory Board meeting out of Vandenberg, and I asked Samantha to bring it forward, let the council hear it, and also the public. Even though we all that live in Lompoc, we're not real happy with the snowy plover program, but I believe what you're going to hear from Samantha is somewhat encouraging. It's not all good news, but it's I was encouraged after the presentation, so Samantha, please.
Good. Well, I think he's trying to pull up my slides right now. But yes, I'm Samantha Kaiserstadt, and I'm a biologist at Vandenberg, and I'm primarily responsible for the snowy plover and beach management, among other things. So tonight, I just want to talk to you about our past season, some of our successes and some of our challenges as we head into the 2016 season, which starts on March 1st. It's just a few short weeks away, which is amazing. It always comes so quickly. So he's, I don't know what he's doing. He's finding the slides that I have for you guys tonight. I swear, I brought them.
You know, while we're waiting for that, maybe we can have the city manager's report.
Thank you, Mayor. A couple things I wanted to alert you to. Number one, with the recent storm activity and the high winds we had, I'm pleased to report that our incidents as a result were fairly minor. We did have some palm fronds that got on some electric lines, and we had a small area blackout for a bit, but outside of that, we fared much better than we did 13 months ago with the December 14th storm. And maybe part of the reason we did so well this time is we already went through a cleaning, if you will, with that previous storm. And also just my thanks to the Public Works and Electric staff who have done a lot to help get prepared for the onset of storms like this. I also wanted to raise to your attention, Council, that there's been a number of complaints that have been getting received over both pull trailers in that are parked like in the streets on curbs and also with shopping carts. Looks to me like perhaps we'd be able to be more effective in those areas if we toughen them up, but they don't, if we toughened up our ordinances, but that doesn't come without some controversy. So just give you a heads up, I'll probably be bringing something forward in the near future, so we might be able to have some discussion and try to gauge what council's desire would be in that regard and how we go forward on those things. Don't know, Mayor, if you wanted to talk about vendor carts at this point as well?
Sure, we can bring up as well.
Is she ready?
She's not ready yet. So we also have an issue with, and we'll have to bring this back, bring it back as a council request earlier or later this evening. Our ordinance does not fully address the push carts, the little push carts that we have in the city. It allows them in the Old Town area, but no place else. So during council requests later on, I'm going to be asking to have it brought back to the council. Maybe we can tweak that ordinance a little bit. Councilmember Starbuck.
Let me interject in here. I see Mr. Rarig here. I've talked with him numerous times. There are three separate ordinances that involve push carts. The only one that is push cart friendly is the Old Town specific plan. We have a traffic ordinance that says arrest them, and then we have a regular zoning ordinance that says ticket, cite them, and get them out of town. So there's three ordinances that would have to be reviewed simultaneously to this.
Okay, well, it's not on the agenda, so we really can't be discussing this, but we'll be requesting it to come back at a future council meeting so we can discuss it. Mr. Attorney, am I right there? Okay, how are we doing over here at the presentation? You ready?
That does conclude my report, so.
Okay, good. Thank you. Okay, you ready? Let's go then, okay.
Okay. So, first of all, I wanted to talk about some of the regulatory requirements behind our beach management and our snowy plover management on Vandenberg. There are many components to our snowy plover management during the nesting season, which extends from March 1st through the end of September. The first one is certain sections of beaches are open and certain sections of beaches are closed for the nesting season. So we are required to enforce those beach closures with fencing and signs that we put up at the beginning of the season and take down at the end. The second part of our snowy plover management is monitoring. We have biological monitors out there on a daily basis that are monitoring the breeding success and reproductive success throughout the nesting season. Also, we do periodic wintering surveys. We just had our big winter window survey that's done throughout the range of the snowy plover. One of the biggest management activities we conduct on Vandenberg is predator management. Two of the biggest predators we see on base are coyotes and ravens, but we also get some predation by birds of prey, such as peregrine falcon and red-tailed hawks and other things that we have to manage throughout the year. And then the last thing we do is habitat enhancement. If you guys have been out to some of the beaches on Vandenberg lately, during the winter is when we primarily do a lot of our habitat enhancement. You'll see people on Polaris's treating weeds and other things in the dunes. So the biggest thing of our habitat enhancement is restoration of the dunes back to a more natural open dune system. It is currently infested with a lot of weeds at this point. So we're busy trying to create more habitat for the snowy plover to nest in. So just a little bit about Vandenberg. We have almost 15 linear miles of sandy beaches, which the snowy plover nests on. And on North Base, Minuteman Beach here at the very top is open for recreational access to people with base access. And then that stretch of beach goes all the way down here past Parisima Point. And only the section at Minuteman is open during the nesting season, and the remainder is closed during the nesting season, and that's all within the base boundaries. And here on South Base, the nesting beaches extend from here up at Wall Beach, and Wall Beach, there's a portion that's open for recreational access to for people with base access throughout the nesting season. And then extends all the way down here past Slick 4. Surf Beach is right here at the south end of the San Ynez River mouth. This is the section that's open to the general public, and then the rest of the beach is closed during the nesting season. So I want to talk a little bit about our recovery goals. These recovery goals are set by the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service in the recovery plan. And throughout the range of the snowy plover is from southern Washington into Baja, California. So it's a very large range. We are here in Recovery Unit 5, which is encompasses Ventura, Santa Barbara, and San Luis Obispo counties. And we have the biggest chunk of birds. Our recovery goals are the biggest in Recovery Unit 5, and our recovery goal for our entire unit is 1,200 breeding adults, or about 40% of the entire population of the western snowy plover. And then within Recovery Unit 5, we have Vandenberg Air Force Base, and our recovery goal is 400 breeding adults base-wide. That is about 25% of the entire population of the snowy plover. Vandenberg currently supports the largest population of the snowy plover, and the reason why is because the base is really prevented development in the area and has left these beaches really untouched. A lot of these beaches are around launch complexes and things, and so they've just remained undeveloped, whereas you don't see that in other areas of California. Basically, the snowy plover has been extinct from Los Angeles County, because if you think of LA County, they have development all the way to the beaches. They have these little linear stretches of beaches that they groom and mow, and so therefore there's no plovers left, whereas Vandenberg is a pretty natural area. So we currently have, and our recovery goal is to support the largest number of breeding snowy plovers throughout the range. So I want to talk a little bit about how we currently are doing to meet that 400 breeding adult recovery goal. In the 2015 nesting season, we were at 309 breeding adults, which is great. We've only reached our recovery goal one time, and that was in 2004. We have to maintain that recovery goal over a period of 10 years. So we can't just say, okay, we met it, we're done. No, they want to see that you can sustain that population over a period of time. So we had a dramatic increase in nesting snowy plovers during the 2015 season. And we had 437 nests established base-wide in 2015. If you look at the prior year, in 2014, we had 427 nests. And you may ask, well, why didn't you have that much more? You had so many more breeding adults this year. Well, because our predator control efforts were much better in 2015. So we expect to see high nesting numbers in years where we have high nest predation. So if you're getting a bunch of your nests eaten by predators, then they re-nest. So you want to see your nesting adults go up and your number of nests established stay stable or relatively low. That's a good indicator of predator management. So in 2015, we determined all the fates of our known nests, and the majority of our nests, about 60% of them, successfully hatched throughout the season. And then the largest percentage of failed nests were due to predation. We had a few that were abandoned, a few that get washed by the tide or blown over with sand during high wind events. But for the most part, our hatch rate was really good in 2015. So of the predated nests that we had, about 77% were predated by coyotes. Again, we have a natural area out there. We have a lot of coyotes running free. So the highest number of predated nests were due to coyote. And then we had a few to some other things, skunks, gulls, and ravens. Our raven control was great this year. Have a lot of nests lost to ravens. Ravens can really decimate a breeding colony. They can come in one day and take all of your nests, and they key into that area, and they'll just keep coming back. And there's some years where we've had almost complete nest failure due to ravens, and they also predate chicks and other things. So we've had some really hard years due to ravens, but thankfully 2015 was a good year. So we had 257 nests that hatched this year, which is really great. It is the highest number of nests that we've ever had hatch. If you look throughout the graph, you can see 245 nests was the previous number, highest nest hatch rate we had, and that was in 2006. But this graph shows the percentage of hatched nests. So what this graph is showing is that we are right in line where we should be as far as percentage of hatched nests, but we're also producing, we're getting more overall to hatch. And that's what helps us meet our recovery goals. So we band chicks at the nest site. We put these little color bands. If you guys have been out to surf and you've seen the plovers running around, if you look really carefully, you can see that a lot of them have these little color bands, and that's how we track chicks And that's how we can tell if they're surviving to fledging. And in 2015, we banded almost 51% of all the nests that hatched. And we determine fledging after we see them 28 days later. So our fledge success in 2015, again, right in line with what we should be, about half of all of our chicks that hatched fledged. And this is what gets more birds into the breeding population. This is what we want to see. We want to see more chicks fledging every year so that we can get that nesting number up the next year. So for enforcement of beach restrictions, again, the beach restrictions are in effect from March 1st through September 30th every year, and that's a really long season. And violation limits are imposed per the terms and conditions of the biological opinion for beach management with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. These are regulatory documents that are required under federal law for Vandenberg to consult with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, another federal agency that manages threatened and endangered species. So these aren't things that Vandenberg likes to do. It's all mandated per our regulatory documents with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. And every entry into a closed area counts against the violation limit. So even footprints in the closed area will count against the violation limit. And once that violation limit is reached, that section of beach is closed for the remainder of the breeding season. It'll be closed until September 30th if we reach that violation limit. So Minuteman and Wall Beach, which I previously showed you where those are, open to base access only, they have violation limits of 10 violations throughout the breeding season, whereas Surf Beach, which is open to the general public, it has a violation limit of 50. That's quite a bit more. It's about the same amount of area, too. But the base population is a little bit better controlled, whereas, you know, you can't always control everybody that's coming down to Surf Beach. They might not be familiar with all of the restrictions that are in place there. So Surf Beach reached 50 violations again on June 3rd in 2015, which was the fourth consecutive year that Surf Beach closed early during the nesting season. So here's a look at how we've done since beach violation limits were imposed starting in 2001. Surf Beach has always remained higher than the other beaches, but we saw a dramatic increase starting in 2012. And then from then on, we reached our violation limit midway through the season and Surf was closed. Minuteman was closed once in 2006 after it reached its violation limit. And Wall Beach has come close a few times, but has never reached the violation limit. So one thing we started to do after the 2012 season when we first closed Surf Beach was to bring back the docent program. We used to have a docent program many years ago, but somehow it just fell to the wayside and then we didn't have a docent program. So when Surf Beach closed for the first time, we decided it was important for us to bring back the docent program. And the goals of the docent program are to educate the beach visitors on where the closed and open areas are. Basically, this is closed area, this is open, stay within this area, otherwise we'll get a violation and it'll be counted against the violation limit and the beach will be closed. And explaining why that's important for everyone to understand and to be able to maintain the beach being open. And also, one of our goals of the docent program, which we haven't quite met, is to maintain a physical presence for the entire time that the beach is open. So when it opens first thing in the morning to when it closes, that's our goal for the docent program. But of course, we need a lot of people, and that we haven't quite got there. Our docent program has been improving every year, and it's gotten better and better. But Another thing that we've started to do as far as the docent program is more community outreach and education. I think it's after seeing the beach being closed year after year, there, and the docents are out there, what something I've seen is people not necessarily paying attention to what the docents are telling them or caring about it, and then trying to sneak in other areas. So we've decided to start going into the community and try to educate people in the schools and other things about why this is important for everyone. So a little bit about our habitat restoration program. We've been doing habitat restoration on large areas now. The habitat restoration started about 7 years ago. And if you've been out to Surf Beach within the last few years, you probably noticed that we took a bulldozer and we bulldozed the whole thing. And that was after we treated and killed all the weeds out there, we went back to recontour it to a more natural state, because the Ammophila, the beach grass, collects sand and it builds these big dune ridges right up on the foredune. So we went, after all the weeds were killed, to recontour that area to a more natural state. And it actually looks a lot better, too. And the plovers are certainly responding to these areas. And we completed dune contouring at Surf in 2014, and we had 38 nests established in that area that breeding season. And in this past year, we had 27 nests established within the contoured area in 2015. So they're continuing to use it. It's coming back very nicely. A lot of natives out there now, and no weeds, which is great. So again, it just created more nesting habitat for the snowy plover to be. If there's more habitat, there's more area for people and other things. So we're increasing the nesting habitat. That benefits the species, that helps us reach our recovery goal, and that allows us to get to less restrictions quicker. We completed contouring of Wall Beach in 2015, and we had 38 nests established in that area in 2015. So before we started habitat restoration in these areas, we had zero nests. Plovers did not nest in these areas at all. So they're definitely responding to the habitat restoration on base. And we started last year a restoration of all of Minuteman Beach, which is about 840 acres or 4 linear miles of beaches. So we're just in the beginning stages there of trying to eradicate some of the non-native invasive species. And this is a look here on how visually the plovers have responded to habitat restoration. This is Wall Beach here at the north part of the San Ynez River, and this is Surf Beach here on the south. So look in these areas. This is just the beachfront here, and all of our nests were restricted right here to the beachfront. This is where people like to walk and other things. So all of our nests, this is what, you know, why we have beach closures, because just walking down the beach, you can step on a nest, step on a chick, not even know it. Because all the plovers were nesting right here in front. And in 2014, this is when we recontoured this area of Surf. And you saw plovers moving into this area, and the density of plovers decreased here on the beachfront, and they're a little bit more spread out. They're definitely using this area now. And this is what the nesting distribution looked like this past season. Here's the contoured area at Wall, and here's the contoured area at Surf. Plovers are starting to move back in this area where they should be. This is more traditional habitat for them. When they're all scrunched up in the front like this, they're more susceptible to predation and other things. Somebody violating the closed beach area, just walking down the sand on the beach, you know, stepping on nests, stepping on chicks, whereas here they're more spread out, as they should be, which has helped our nesting success. And this is why we're starting to see an increase of breeding adults and hatch success and fledgling successes, because they have more habitat here to nest in. And that's it. Does anyone have any questions? Feel free to ask me questions.
Samantha, I've got a comment. That last chart with the beach contouring, if I recall when I was at the meeting on the base, the coyotes seemed to run up and down the beach, and on the backside of the dunes, they don't necessarily go in there. Is that?
That's correct. So another thing we're seeing in these areas that we've restored is that they have the lowest predation rate of any other section breeding habitat on base. And the reason why is because, like I said, when they're all scrunched in the front, you have predators like coyotes who just wander up and down the beachfront, and then they just take all the nests. Again, like ravens, they'll just fly down the beach, and they just pick them off one by one. Whereas when they have more habitat, they're more camouflaged and spread out, and coyotes don't necessarily wander into the back dunes like that. So we've seen a very high success rates within those restored areas as well.
Councilmember Starbuck.
Obviously, they're very important to national security, the way you're protecting them out there. I've watched this brief a while before, and one of the things that wasn't brought up here was I understood there was a lot of them that just died because they froze to death out there, and this didn't show any of that.
Well, again, here I can rewind it. Of course, plovers are susceptible to weather, right? I mean, right. They're a small little bird that lives out on the beach in a really harsh environment.
Yeah, you picked the worst environment on earth to try and bring the plovers back. Why don't we take them down south where it's a real nice Mediterranean climate and they'll thrive?
Well, because that's why people love it there too. And that's why those areas are so developed compared to Vandenberg. I mean, the heart of the habitat would probably be, you know, Los Angeles, Ventura, Orange counties where the weather's nicer, but there's just no habitat there left like there is here on Vandenberg. But so one thing, if you look at this graph here on the number of breeding adults, so some of the universities did some studies on why they think, you know, on certain years they could look at everybody. So they'll look at our recovery unit, they'll look throughout the range and see, is everybody seeing an increase or decrease? And then, so in this time frame here, 2014, everybody throughout our recovery unit saw an increase of snowy plover breeding adults. Whereas like here, this year, we can partially attribute that to our habitat restoration because we're the only ones that saw this year. Everybody else, our neighbors to the north and south, they did not see this dramatic increase like we did. But on some of these years, like 2004, throughout our recovery unit, everybody was seeing that. So they went back and looked at weather patterns. And this winter here between 2003 and 2004 was a really mild winter. So we didn't have very many nights of overnight freezing temperatures. So we would not expect to see a lot of adult mortality through that winter. Whereas here in 2005, we had a harsh winter where we had sustained periods of overnight freezing temperatures. This winter has really been a harsh winter out on the beaches, right? There's been a lot of beach erosion. It's just, you know, it'd be really hard to be a little bird out there. So we expect that we probably would have, you know, high adult mortality through this winter. So that's why we have to maintain our recovery goal over a 10-year period. So they want to see that you can maintain that recovery goal through the good and the bad, through the harsh winters and the easy winters. So it's just not 1 year, it's a fluke, but that you can sustain that breeding population for an extended period of time.
Councilmember Mosby.
How much does this habitat restoration cost with all the bulldozer work and such? What do you?
It's not cheap. The base is dedicated to keeping recreational access on the beaches. A lot of times I'll hear from commanders and things, why are we spending so much money on these programs? Monitoring every year, just our monitoring costs are so high. Our enforcement, fences, everything, it costs the base a lot of money. But the base is dedicated to keeping recreational access for everybody.
How much does it cost again? You said not cheap. What's that equal to?
Well, for example, the 840 miles that we're doing at Minuteman Beach, we got a congressional appropriation for $725,000 for that.
And that's for the bulldozing?
Well, that includes all the weed treatment and bulldozing for that section.
Next question.
It's over a five-year period. It's not just 1 year, but it's for restoration of that with that section. Because again, it's, you know, it's mandated by the Endangered Species Act. It's mandated by our biological opinion with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. It's a must-do for the base.
How many of these fledged chicks, where do they go? How many survive? How many come back? Do they stay here or do they relocate or what do they do?
So that's another thing that some of the universities love to get into those kind of studies. But for the most part, the majority of our fledglings stay here and nest here. But they also, they're migratory, so they can go nest up in Northern California or down south. A certain percentage will move around, but the majority will stay here and nest. But also, another thing we can tell by banding, and another thing that we found out during our range-wide meeting this year, is that Vandenberg is also pulling in a lot of the birds and fledglings from our neighbors because we're improving habitat. So like Oceano Dunes to the north of us, they have a very small area that they fence off for nesting. And we're seeing some of their fledglings come and nest in on the base because it's better habitat. We're enticing them to come and breed here. So
isn't it true that they prefer warmer climates, though, that a lot of them go south?
Right.
And then don't come back. They go down Santa Barbara, Santa Monica. And
but
then
again,
they
breeding habitat. That's what they care about. So, yes, as you go north in the range, the density of snowy plovers decrease. So in southern Washington, they may have two or three nesting plovers on an entire five-mile stretch of beach. They have very few as compared to we do. But again, the habitat in the warmer areas like Orange County, their habitat is almost completely gone. So they are starting to see fewer and fewer.
Climatically, it's better down there, though, right?
Yeah.
So maybe some beaches down there with some bulldozers or something. Maybe they could.
Well, the homeowners probably wouldn't like that too much.
I know we used to love we love our beach out there too. I'm sure they love them over there and they protect them. But I mean, ours kind of got a little blindsided out here in our beach. We weren't able to rally the troops to, you know, and say, hey guys, maybe you guys need to share the enhancement to the other zones. Which it seems like our beach really. You know, got swallowed up and taken by plovers, where a lot of other places, which are better habitats, but just because man is there, they're not better habitats.
Right, exactly. So plovers won't come into an area and nest if there's high human use of that air. If there's a lot of people, plovers won't even come. They're very skittish birds. Areas where people are, plovers won't be.
Okay. Well, Samantha, thank you very much. No. You'll be able to have public comment later. You can do that. Samantha, thank you very much for coming. You are the messenger.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, and maybe we'll get you back again next year. So.
Okay,
thank you. Okay, this is public comment on the consent calendar. You have up to 3 minutes to talk to us. Anything on the consent calendar? And just for your information, City Clerk, are we pulling number 3? That's what I was told. No? Consent calendar? Okay. Okay, so public comment on the consent calendar, up to 3 minutes. Anyone? No, consent calendar. Okay, seeing no one come forward, we're going to close public comment and bring the consent calendar to the council. No, this is consent calendar only, Ron. So, okay, so the consent calendar consists of items that are considered to be routine, and they will be it will be approved by one motion and a roll call vote by the council, unless a council member chooses to pull an item, and in that case, that will be addressed later on or separately. So, does any council member choose to pull an item? No.
I move we accept consent calendar.
I'll second.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded. Can we vote, please? And that passes 5-0. Thank you. Okay, now we're going to have a staff presentation. Economic Development Director and Assistant City Manager Teresa Galavan.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of council. It's my pleasure to introduce our new Development Program Specialist 1, Jasmine McGinty. Come on up, Jasmine. Jasmine will be working with us specifically in economic development. She's from Lompoc. She went to college at the University of California, San Diego, where she did a double major in urban studies and planning and communications. She worked there as a student manager for the UCSD Housing and Dining, and she was also a real estate intern with Harkert's Prestige Properties. She graduated this past June, and we're very delighted that she's returned to her hometown and joined the city team, where her work is going to have a positive impact on the community. Jasmine's already started working on updating our available property list and our marketing materials, and among other economic development projects. So please give her a warm welcome.
Well, like Teresa said, I'm Jasmine McGinty, and I'm very excited to be here and back in my hometown. I just moved back from San Diego, so I'm excited to be here and working with all of you and with Teresa and the Economic Development Department. So thank you for having me.
Well, thank you for coming. Okay, now we're going to have oral communication where any member of the public can come up and speak to us for 3 minutes on any item you so choose.
Could you pass those to the council members, please? Thank you. Good evening, Mayor and Council. My name is Michael Baker, CEO for United Boys and Girls Club Santa Barbara County. I just wanted to come and give an update as to how things are going. As I mentioned to you, we were ending last year, and we ended very strongly. We ended the year... We actually doubled our average daily attendance at all of our clubs across the county. Lompoc really set the pace for all of our clubs. Our outreach efforts here in Lompoc were absolutely tremendous, reaching kids who need the services the most. And I could tell you that expanding the Saturdays and having more kids come more often was a major, major accomplishment this past year. One of the things that you'll see in the annual report there, and I encourage you to please look at that and really, really dig through it. It's pretty impressive, some of the things that have happened this past year. What we've been able to do, which is just absolutely unheard of in Boys and Girls Clubs, is 80% of our members, 80% of the, we have 3,191 members last year, and that number was up significantly as well. 80% of those members come at least three times a week to the Boys and Girls Club. That's absolutely unheard of in Boys and Girls Club work, getting kids to come that often, so that's a significant accomplishment. And the studies have shown that if we can get children to come to the Boys and Girls Club on an average of two times per week, which we call 105 times a year, basically. Studies have shown that they're twice as likely to graduate college and get them at an early age, get them involved in the Boys and Girls Club. So we've developed an actual program that we have two different things that we're doing. Number one is we issue the regular membership card to all the children at the Boys and Girls Club. This will get them into any program that we have at the Boys and Girls Club. Then when they attain 52 days that they've attended the Boys and Girls Club, they're going to receive a silver card. This is going to get them to some special activities, encouraging kids to come more often. And then when they come 105 times for the year, they'll get a gold card. And when we have the ceremony, we would give out the gold cards. That'll happen once a month. We're going to be inviting every one of you down to the Lompoc Club to be there to help present those to those kids, because it's the more often they come, the more deeper impact we can have with the children, the bigger difference we can make. So with that, I want to again thank each and every one of you for your continued support. And if you haven't been down there recently, I strongly encourage you to come down to the Lompoc Club and see what's happening, because it's making a world of difference for those kids. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Baker. Next, please.
Yeah, I'm here to talk about some things I can't get accomplished out front. I own three buildings in Lompoc that are commercial. And when they become unoccupied, I come down here and I wanted to get the service turned off for the electrical and something like that, but I wanted to keep the water on because I needed to clean up and do things like that. There's always use for water and to do things. And the utilities committee, they told me I wasn't allowed to do that. So I wrote them a little letter and gave it to them. That's been about 5 months ago or more, nothing back. I just gave them another one the other day, but now the the toilets in there have all gone dry. The whole interior of the building smell like sewage. I want somebody to pay for this. I don't know why you can't have your water on and not the rest of the powers. I checked with other cities and they all said you can have anything on you want. Do you guys have an answer? I tried to get a hold of city administrator today and I've tried him a few other times and I still can't get a hold of anybody. You guys ignore us. I don't know why, but I'm pretty disgusted with it. Do you guys have any kind of an answer for me here about the power and the water, why you can't leave water on in a building for somebody to keep it clean?
Well, Ray, you and I talked, I'll just address it real quickly. You and I did talk last week and I checked on it. You and or your wife were given an option to leave the water on and you chose not to.
No.
Okay, well this is, okay.
No, in fact, I just filled out a whole piece of paper here just the last 3 days ago trying to get it turned on again. And we were not given an option. If we were given an option, I would have turned it on immediately.
Okay. Well, okay, this isn't the forum for...
You have that in writing.
...for this discussion, but...
It is a forum for that because I can't get a hold of anybody during the day, so somebody needs to do something about it. It is a forum for it. It really is.
Mr. Mayor, this gentleman has filed a claim against the city regarding the same thing, so my recommendation to you is be not having more comment on this from the council.
Okay. Okay, Ray, so anything else you'd like to say?
Pardon?
Anything else you'd like to say?
I want to know if you guys are going to turn the water on.
We've just been advised by our city attorney that because you have filed a claim against the city, we should not be having this discussion.
It's still a health problem. I mean, this is a total health problem. This here's filling the whole building up with sewer gas. Don't we understand that? I don't care what we talk about or how much money it costs.
Okay.
That doesn't make any sense. We need to do something about this. And I come down here, and I have been down here three or four times in the last week, and nobody wants to talk to me about it.
Okay. Thank you. You've had your 3 minutes now.
You're not going to give me an answer.
I don't have an answer to give you. Thank you, Mr. Leslie. Next, please.
Good evening. I'm Ron Rarick, owner, Dogfather in front of Home Depot. We have a food cart that is top of the line. We made it ourselves. It's metal. It has preparation for hot dogs of the gourmet variety. I'm sure many of you are familiar with it. We have tried to come to locations to make it successful, make it serve a purpose of making some money for Dogfather. And recently we came across a site that we think is very, very inviting. It's at Walnut and H on the Walnut, on the west side of Walnut, or on H. And we slip in there. It just seems to be a significantly good idea. We've had people coming to us and they're asking, where have you been? When are you coming back? And we said, well, we don't know because we were asked not to be there. Now, this is confusing. Because we do have all of the licenses and all of the city permits that I can think of. The fire people like us, the police like us, but for some reason this 1965 city code has got wording in it that is most confusing. And it not becoming of a city to have a code that goes back that far without being updated, because 1965 is a long time ago, as we know. And I'm asking that you look at it and give us permission, either directly or through innuendo, that we might go there and pursue business. Lompoc's a wonderful place. I love it. I've been here for 10 years. It has nowhere to go but up. It's going to be great. I sound like, what's his name? Trump. So let's make it great. Give us some information. Let us do our job. We do a fine job. People like us. And the only thing we can do is turn to you for help of getting this code updated so that we can pursue the business. Make sense? Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Next. Okay. No one, seeing no one rise, we're going to close roll communication.
Bob? What? Okay. I want to comment.
Go ahead.
Yeah, follow on that up. I want this council to have hold a meeting on that, because I'm getting sick and tired of some of the things that have been happening with these rigs and such and around town. Someplace you can see them work is not. I'd like to have us a discussion on that 65 ordinance or whatever it was that has been causing problems for the last 5 years.
Okay, so during public comment, during public or council requests, we'll be discussing that. Okay, so oral communication is closed. We're going to move on to appointments. First is a council appointment to fill a vacancy on the Beautification Commission. And we have two terms. One recommendation, this is Council Member Vega's recommended appointment. Council Member Vega, would you like to make a nomination?
Yeah, I'd like to nominate Roberta Badiger to the Beautification Commission.
I'll second.
Okay, I have a second. Any discussion? Okay, let's vote on that. And that passes 5-0. Is Ms. Badiger here? Okay. Next we're gonna have, we're gonna go on to Council at large appointments to the, where are we right here? Beautification, no, okay. We're gonna go on to the Airport Commission first. Airport Commission has, there are four at-large commissions open, and we have four people that have been put in their applications. These are four at-large commissions that with the term ending in January of 2020. So, Councilmember Humdahl.
The four of them have been doing a good job. I'd like to go ahead and reappoint them. So my motion would be to reappoint.
The entire slate?
Entire slate.
Okay. And I'll second it.
No. This is just for the Airport Commission.
Just the Airport Commission.
Okay, do I have a second?
I second it.
Okay, we have motion and a second. Any discussion? Let's vote. Okay, that passes 5-0. Okay, we're gonna move on to the Library Commission. The Library Commission, we have one term ending in January of 18 and two terms ending January of 19. We have one person that is, well, it's actually two people putting in their applications for the 19. So do we have a motion to approve the two for the two terms ending January of 2019? Okay, I will move that we nominate Ms. Knowles and Mr. Marks as Library Board trustees. Well, actually, this is not trustees, these are commissioners now.
Commissioners, and I'll second it.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded. Any discussion? Let's vote. And that passes 5-0. And now we have the Senior Commission. We have two terms expiring January of 2020. And we have two applications, Mr. Robert Kennedy and Ms. Mary Lou Parks. Do I have a motion or discussion?
I move their appointment.
Okay.
I'll second.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded. Any discussion? Let's vote. And that passes 5-0. Okay, and then we have the Youth Commission. For the Youth Commission, we have one adult term that will be ending January of 2018, four youth terms ending January of 18, and one non-voting term ending January of 18. We have a application from one adult, Ms. Beverly Kennedy, and we have two applications for the two applications for the full terms, the voting positions ending January of 18. That is Edith Vargas and Brianna Gonzalez. And then we have one application for the non-voting position, Stacy Rawlings. Any discussion on these four individuals? Would someone like to make a motion?
Move their appointment.
I'll second.
Any discussion? Okay, let's vote. Okay, so there are, that remains, there'll be two, there's still two terms open for the Youth Commission now. So any youth out there that is looking to serve the city? Okay. Okay, we're going to move on to discussion on item number 5, which is discussion of consideration approving the proposal for Public Facility Investment Corporation. No, that's right. What are you doing to me, Dwayne?
Second.
No, it's number 6. Okay, okay, number 6. Okay, Mr. Weimiller.
I'm going to turn this over to Chief Latipau to make the initial presentation.
Mr. Mayor, members of the council, thank you very much for giving us the opportunity to present this project to you one more time. If you'll bear with me, I won't go through the entire set of slides that you've seen in the past. But I just would kind of like to share a little history, most of which you already know. Some members at home and some members in the audience may not. So if you'll, I'll get through it very, very quickly, I think. There we go. So we talked a lot about the future, and you've heard me say catch up. So catching up and looking forward, I think it's interesting to note that in 2004, we were running about 2,800 calls. Since that time, our workload has increased 48.6%. And we're hitting this average, 4.4 per year. So our projections are right on. We are a high demand city, and I'll show you that in a minute. Our response increases do not necessarily match the population increase. However, we have increased population by about 1,600 in the last year. I'm going to show you some charts. You know, we look at a lot of data, and we balance data with what we see on the ground, so to speak. So these charts are out of our master plan that was adopted back in 13. So comparison of incidents per 1,000 population is something we look at very closely as we prepare for the future, but also as we prepare to serve today. The regional median is 64.1 per 1,000. We're actually above the national median at 86.8. And you know, a lot of people ask me, why is that? There's multiple factors that contribute to that. One of them is our density, one of them is our multifamily housing, one of them is our socioeconomic, one of them is tourism. So there's a lot of contributing factors that drive use. firefighters per population, this comparison typically comes from ICMA, International City County Managers Association, where their documents recommend X number of firefighters per population. We are very proud of the fact that this team does an incredible job serving this community with the lowest firefighter per 1,000 population, but that also explains some of the workload. So facilities, you already know this, it's not new. The last addition to fire department facilities was the construction of fire station number 2 in 1985. Depending on who you talk to, that was meant to be a temporary station. And in talking with Chief Reed, who built that station or who commissioned that station to be built, that station allowed the development of housing in that area. So, as you all know, the team has been living and breathing this project for quite some time. I dug in to some notes that I found in a file. Some were from Chief Caceres, some were from Chief White. And then I opened up the approved 15-year capital improvement plan for years 2003 to 2017 for the city. I do have a copy of that with me this evening. So there's a lot of projects in there, and obviously any CIP is dependent upon revenue and the ability to afford the improvements. So the first one was relocate Fire Station 2 to the northern section of the city, and the projection for that to happen was 2005-2006. The recommendation was to construct that station to accommodate two fully staffed apparatus, three per unit, and the station was to include a classroom for training and meetings and other accoutrements, but not administrative staff. Interesting enough, and I had heard this rumor that there was some thought about remodeling Station 1. In the CIP is a remodel of Fire Station 1 to relieve overcrowding of the administrative areas, and it projected that we would do that in 2009-2010. The intent, there's several bullets, but the two that I kind of latched onto was to improve crews quarters to accommodate gender segregation and improve storage and parking. The design here, which we don't have a formal design, but when you read the narrative, basically they were going to demo all the one-story stuff behind the station, rebuild it to be two-story. And then this was I'd heard this when I first got here, and some of you and I have talked about this. In the 15-year CIP is addition of a third fire station to be constructed around 2011-2012. And then this is part of the narrative that was submitted to justify the addition into the CIP. And it talks about the city growth projections. It talks about attracting new development and how necessary it is to implement a facility plan. And it identified that the construction of the third station would begin in 2012, which, interesting enough, is when I was hired. You've seen these recommendations before, but not in this manner necessarily. The master plan was adopted by council with the objectives. The master plan recommends we add three additional firefighters per shift to be made available to ensure an adequate response. I have a variation on that that's a little cheaper. Implement a reserve firefighter program, which we're in the process of doing right now. We're a little hamstrung on space for those folks, but we're moving forward anyway. Improve internal administrative support capacity, add an additional administrative support person. This one is new. Add a full-time fire prevention specialist, and when I bring you the updated master plan, I'll give you all the justifications for that. Add a program manager position who can manage the department's training program, EMS program, and others with the assistance of operations personnel. Right now, all of our personnel, most of which are on 56-hour work weeks, are carrying extremely heavy collateral duties in addition to supervising their crews. So, this is a real basic recommendation. It's a variation of what you've received from me before, but now that I've dug into that CIP, I think it's important that I kind of massage this a little bit. construct a replacement for fire station number 2 that's is of an appropriate size to house sufficient apparatus, crews, administrative support, training, meeting rooms, yes, and EOC, serve the community's needs for years to come, and eliminate the need for a third fire station for the foreseeable future, or in the foreseeable future. Unless council plans on significant annexations, I truly believe that what we're proposing in this multi-company station that will accommodate administrative staff will serve the city quite well. You already know where it's at. It's at Aviation or No, has not changed. It's designed very specifically, and I don't believe I've spent enough time explaining that, but the way we have sited this on the site is very, very specific. It has a direct access to the intersection. The more turns you reduce, the more you enhance your response times. You've already seen my response modeling. We put that to bed a couple of meetings ago. And that's the station. So that is an extremely high flight through a multi-page staff report. The only variation in the staff report is the disclaimer that in the event you graciously allow us to move forward, I will have to go back for a freshened up quote. I did make an attempt, as I promised you, to lock in that $14 million and some change. The response was, when you're ready to move forward, we'll see what we can do. If you recall, we started this project at $16 million. When we started negotiating with your approval, with the lenders, they started negotiating with contractors. The first contractor they negotiated with came in at almost $16 million, back up to the $16 million figure. The second contractor is the one that came in at the $14 million and some change. I know it's a lot of money. There's been a lot of discussion. It's amazing how many subject matter experts there are out there. But just as a comparison for square footage, I did some digging on Santa Maria Station. I've given you erroneous information on that station. It's a 6,500 square foot station. The total cost was $4.2 million. It's a two-bay single company station. Construction only was $2.3 million. All the other stuff, the fees, the furnishings, et cetera, rolled it up to $4.2 million. Depending on who you talk to, the per square footage of construction, for the most part, is the building. It's not all the furnishings, and it's not all the permits, it's the building. So they built at the height of the recession, about 3.25 a square foot. Goleta, which it's interesting, after our last meeting, my inbox, my email in basket filled up with the NewsHawk article on the Goleta station. So I secured their staff report, their PowerPoint. That's an 11,000 square foot station, three bays, with the ability to support up to five firefighters. Currently, Goleta is served by one engine company. Cost construction only was $4.4 million, 400 a square foot. Their total projected construction is $7.6 million per their staff report. So we're in ballpark. We believe we're more than in ballpark. Construction only, we pegged at around $350 a square foot. However, we did something a little different. We added an escalator in there because we're uncertain when we'll be moving forward. That's why we're hoping that you'll give us that direction tonight. So once you bump the escalator in there, we could be as high as $395 a square foot. So that's my presentation. Like I promised not to revisit everything I've shown you over the last several months. And, well, I lost the members of the internal design team who were here. That's all I have for you. I'm willing to answer any questions you may wish to push my way.
So, Chief, if I'm getting you correct, the Santa Maria station, as built, was about $325 a square foot.
Construction only.
Construction only. Construction only of the Goleta station, this is also construction only about $400 a square foot?
Correct.
Okay, and then the one that we are proposing, construction only, is about $350 a square foot.
Right, but we factored in an escalation. So That's why I mentioned the $395 a square foot, which puts us pretty close to Goleta.
Okay. Okay. Councilmember Holmdahl.
Yeah, I want to congratulate the chief for doing an excellent job of making the presentation many times and putting together a program that's going to be something worthwhile for the city of Lompoc, for the future of Lompoc. One of the problems we've had in this town is people don't want to look down the road. They don't want to go that far down the road. And I really believe the job he's done, and we put him through the paces. He went back to the quality of the facility we have. Look how, if you looked at the dates and times that we've said we're going to build these things, we're so far behind now of any projection. And the station number two has to be replaced. And so I'm going to still come back to council, but I will be making a motion supporting this.
Okay. Okay, that was not a motion right now.
No.
Okay. Okay, what I'd like to say is, I think all five of us at one time or another have agreed that we need a new station. I think the disagreement is the size of the station and the cost of the station. So maybe we can discuss that a little bit more tonight. The other thing I want to point out is that we as council members, we rely on professionals. We're not professional firefighters. We're not professional public safety people. We are not professional consultants that design fire stations. We are not professional city administrators and professional finance directors. All of these people have given us their best input. The city administrator actually pointed out, I believe, in this public meeting that he's putting his professional reputation on the line that this is a very viable project. He would not be presenting it if it wasn't. And I hope I'm sort of quoting you correctly.
That's pretty close, yep.
Okay. Our finance director, let's see, Mr. Wilkie, yes, Ms. Wilkie is here, has indicated to us and told us that we can afford this station. It's not that, you know, we have abundance of money, but we can afford this station. So again, from my point, I'm relying on these professionals, public safety professionals, professional consultants, that it's their job to design the construction of this type of station, professional administration, professional finance. This is what I am relying on, and I put my trust in them, and I do believe them. So I'm looking forward to this discussion this evening, and hopefully we can come to some consensus that all five of us do still believe we need a new station. Let's just come up with what we really want to present. Councilmember Mosby.
A question for the chief here. The new station and going through the needs analysis documents again, if I can, I asked this question before. I don't know, Mr. Mayor, have you had a chance to read the needs analysis documents?
Word for word, probably not.
Okay, just because I did go through them. And one of the questions I have here is, you know, down the road, we're building this station. If we built this station as built here, you'd be staffing it with 8 firefighters, 2 captains, and 1 BC on duty per shift. So we have 11 in the facility.
Max.
Right. Now, how do we pay for those, or when do we plan on getting to a position where we could pay to staff these?
Well, okay, and let me back up, by the way, make a correction. There are members of the internal design team here who have been living and breathing this document as well, and that was my oversight. I apologize. We pay for them as revenues continue to increase and as demand increases. If we don't increase staffing within 12 to 18 months of moving into this station, we're going to be relying on the county to come in and run our calls for us again. If we don't increase to the level that we can afford and that the risk brings us, we'll have the same challenge. Now, I promised you a station that has future in it. And that's exactly, that is a maximum capacity station with two captains, one on the engine, one on the truck. It is three firefighters on every rig plus the rescue. So all it is bed space. Now, when can we afford that? We have been looking at the numbers, and if I recall, Brad gave me some projections that within 18 months of moving in, we did calculate in enough staff for the additional rescue that I'm recommending as a stopgap. It's cheaper than staffing the truck. They can cross-staff the truck. So that's where we're forecasting, and that's why I'm saying within 12 to 18 months, you're going to need some of the extra space.
All right, so again, I guess better ask Mr. Wilkie then. So Mr. Wilkie, we have eight firefighters on duty, eight firefighters, two captains and one BC on duty. Is there a time frame that in your budgetary analysis that we can come to fill these positions?
Well, the simple answer to that is we're in a two-year budget cycle right now. We'll be beginning the budget cycle process for 17-19, which would likely be the time frame that we're under construction. We'll start doing that in October. So then 2 years later down the line, we'll be doing another budget cycle, which would likely be the time when we would be looking at this. So that's two budget cycles away, and that's entirely up to city administration staff, department staff, and the council to decide the directions and the priorities for that budget that's three cycles away.
So how many of those positions are currently funded for in this budget cycle?
Thank you, because the numbers are getting a little out of sequence. What I am projecting is that within 12 to 18 months of us moving in, and now the move-in date is projected to August of 18. Within 12 to 18 months of moving in, I'm projecting we will need six more people. That's two per shift.
Okay, how many do we currently have that we're paid for of the eight, two, and one?
We currently staff every single day on the floor at nine per shift for both stations. What this station will have is the BC will come out of one and move down to two. So 12 to 18 months from move-in, you'll have the engine staffed, you'll have a BC there, and you'll have an additional rescue. There's three on the engine, one on the BC wagon, and two on the rescue per shift.
Now, okay, so we have those, the two on the rescue are currently in one, right?
We will be adding an additional rescue within 12 to 18 months. So you'll have two rescues. The rescue is staffed with two people per shift.
Okay, let me ask the question. I'm just trying to get down to an answer here. We have two at rescue that are going to be at one that we have right now. So if we don't move them from one, what current positions are we funded for and paying for right now that would be able to fill this facility? Not going 18 months.
Everything except the two additional rescue men.
So we currently would have eight firefighters funded to go there, two captains, one BC during the shift. It says per shift.
The shift at that station will move the battalion chief down there. That's one. The current engine at station two is three. We'll be adding an additional rescue for two more.
Okay, so again, I'm not asking what we're adding.
You currently have six, two, and one.
Right.
Round on all shifts.
You're going to
eight, two, and one.
So you want to go to four firefighters?
No. It is two firefighters that fill the rescue truck.
Right. That's the only add.
Right.
So currently right now, from what I'm following, what we'd have, if we built the new station, we didn't add any other people. If we left the BC at one, or if we take the BC and put them at the new two, we'd have one BC and three firefighters. If we didn't add the rescue, is that correct? You'd have a captain, an engineer, and a...
If we build the station that's proposed, the BC will move down.
Okay, so we'd have four people in this station. It's currently funded right now.
For a short time, there'd be four people in the station.
So currently funded right now, we have four positions paid for that could transfer into that station. if it were built tomorrow.
Yes.
So there'd be four positions.
For a short period of time.
What I'm looking at is if what else that comes along if we buy into the station is that we have we have six more positions that we need to find funding to fill to go to that station. If we max out that station, you got 8, 2, and 1 is what you want to go to that station with. And the BC is already funded, so we need to. I'm trying to find out as analysts, because there are other costs that come along with a bigger station.
Right, but some of the bed space are for the auxiliaries.
But the manning portion isn't what comes along with the station. The station accommodates the staffing expansion you're going to have to have because of the demands for the that staffing doesn't change because of the construction or lack of construction of a fire station. The staffing change grows because of the service demands that are in the community, regardless of the facilities that you have. And I would have answered your question at least starting with the philosophical view, and we can then get into timing and dollars and position counts. But the philosophical answer to that is, as your tax base grows, your demand grows, and so does your ability to pay for those services. So that's where it comes from. We wouldn't be activating that growth unless we had the demand that went along with that. And if you have the demand that goes along with that, you're going to have some driver revenue that goes along with that.
Okay, but my question here, I guess, is because I look at it another level, is we have 11 bedrooms proposed at the new fire station, and I just wanted to see how many people we currently have in there, what would be the level of staffing and what level we end up going with on there. So that we're
fair enough.
That's what I'm trying to ask.
Excellent.
And at what level did it look like when I looked at the budget and when I saw what they had there, I didn't see the room, at least in the foreseeable budget of page 135 that we looked at, that we had the ability to put those. Now, granted, if we had some new revenues, but these are the projections by Mr. Wilkie, and I didn't see the areas and avenues to be able to add and fill these beds. I mean, this is 11 bedrooms. Granted, we're looking at maybe two of those being volunteers in two of those bedrooms.
Well, auxiliaries, not volunteers.
Okay, auxiliaries.
And the rescue squad is a stopgap. I don't know how much clearer to make it. If we build a facility without the bed space and it comes 2020 and the risk increases and the call volume increases, you're not going to have the ability to accommodate the 24-hour staff. We haven't even got to the admin staff.
Okay. Chief, excuse me, go ahead.
I've got a few questions I'd like to ask. I mean,
I just want to quick, but this station is being built as a station that'll accommodate us for the next 40 to 50 years. So we don't have to, I mean, it's, in my opinion, it's better to have the space and not need it, these extra bedrooms, than to, in 5 years, need the space and not have it. I mean, if we don't fill the 11 bedrooms, if we don't need them right now, I mean, we don't need them for another 10 years.
Okay. And I guess one of my, I'll bring something back to you, something called a wastewater plant we built that we're ready. We've got this $105 million facility we're ready for. We're ready for the town. We could double in size, and we're ready for it. And everybody out here had to pay for it. But we are ready. And that's what I'm questioning at, you know, where and at what level are we going to get? But if I can get back with some of my questions.
Go ahead.
Recently at the public safety meeting, you know, you gave out a report here, which I'm glad to see. It was numbers that I've been, it's your total call-outs, your 4,230 incidents that you had. In looking at this, you had type service call, good intent call, and false alarm calls. And that accounted to 28% of the call-outs. And it seems like that's a significant area that you could work on in getting the reductions in that. I mean, you know, that's, you know, tightening up where you're going.
We work on it every day.
Well, I realize, but I mean, we have 28% of the calls that it seems like that we could sandwich down. That's
some of those calls you don't know it's a good intent until you get there, Councilman.
And that was one of the questions that was brought up as well, that if you were able to identify and break those down, because some of them were canceled en route, wrong location, no emergency, you know, items like that. If you break these categories down a little bit more, it'd be easier to identify, you know, what was going on.
We look at our statistics every single week. We work on the false alarm calls. We review all the calls that were going to our skilled nursing facilities. But a lot of those calls, you don't know that the crews are not needed until they arrive. Now, I also commented at that meeting that in the, I believe in the master plan, it's recommended that we increase our dispatch capacity. If we can increase our dispatch capacity, we won't necessarily decrease calls, but we'll decrease the number of code 3 runs.
Okay, and with respect to the master plan, I was going through that, and I didn't see in there where it said that we needed an new EOC and a new admin in there.
That's a valid question. That was not the scope of the master plan. I did not, in the master plan scope of work, it did not ask to make a recommendation for the size and the makeup of a new station. However, if by doing the math, there's physically no way to add the numbers that are being recommended without increasing a station. It does comment on needing another station. One of my roles of being the person who's responsible for the emergency plans and the recovery plans in the city is, in fact, determining what's needed to make that program run. I did not have in the scope of work for the Fire Department Master Plan an evaluation of the status of the readiness of the city nor the EOC. But it, you know, logically, and I apologize, a lot of times I do approach things somewhat logically. It has gotten me in trouble in the past, hopefully not tonight. But it makes sense to me that you would want your EOC in the newest, safest building in the city.
I follow that, but again, you know, every time I kind of bring a comment up, people say, want to refer back to the expert. So, you know, I was going back through the books, reading the black and white, and as it states in the, you know, the reasons for replacing fire station 2, we need something that's a better design, more efficient. We also need something that's better for gender segregation. We needed bigger bays, seismic stability. It broke down the items in there, but again, it wasn't something to add that. And I got you. You're bringing the logic to the table that we needed the EOC. But
council member, that's why we convened the internal design group made up of the people who be in the stations with an architect. This is not the first station I've looked at.
Right, and that brings another question. How did we come around the process of bringing in an RRM as the design group?
I came to the council and requested permission to move forward with looking for an architect. We did an RFQ, and I can't remember now, because it's been a while, how many responses we got. We interviewed all the people that responded, and the internal design team was part of that process. And at the end of the day, they recommended RRM because of their experience, because of their location on the Central Coast, because of the depth that they bring to the table as far as architects, civil engineers, et cetera. So it was not somebody we just went to the book and said, well, we want that guy.
And you had a project manager, and I noticed you guys supplied me with a letter recently on some of the questions I had. And he was the architect in registered in the needs analysis book, but not the project manager. Is the project manager?
The original project manager left the firm within, can't remember how many months of kickoff. He was the assistant, fully credentialed, fully qualified to take the lead, and the firm moved him into the lead position. Michael Scott is his name, sorry.
Yeah, you had Candace Wong originally in there.
Yeah, Candace, it's interesting. Candace was actually part of the process that we did with the Cal Poly students. She was one of their advisors.
Okay. And just a couple of questions for Mr. Wilkie. Why do we have reserve set up in our, well, we try to get it in our utilities, we have reserves in our general fund. Why do we set up reserves?
The policies that we set up for the utilities outlines that in several pages, so it will be kind of hard for me to recite what is in there, but liquidity is helpful for getting through some potential tough times. It's also for just ongoing cash needs.
Is bond rating in there too? With one time that was mentioned to us, we need to keep, because being part of NCPA, we need to make sure that we keep reserves together so we don't.
And that's really only applicable to the entities that have bonds. The general fund has no bonds, so there's no general fund rating that we're needing to be worried about. The rating would be on the water or wastewater utilities, because that's where most of our bonds are. The bonds that we have for the RDAs is in a totally different entity, and it's not even related to the city. So we're just talking the bonds of water and wastewater. And
so
they stand alone.
Would if we dipped our general fund reserves down, it wouldn't affect a potential bond rating in one of the enterprises?
No, because they're standalone. The risk to the enterprise funds is if the council decides not to do a rate increase, that would affect the ability for those funds to pay their bond debt. Then there's a potential for the bondholders to go after the general fund to get that payment. So it's very, very important that the two utilities are collecting enough money to pay for their own way, because the general fund, as a stopgap for everything else, would be what they would go after if the decision was made not to raise rates when they're needing to be raised to meet our bond requirements.
And so, and currently we don't have reserves in water, wastewater, so the general fund is acting as that stopgap then?
There are reserves in water, and the ongoing revenues we are getting every year are enough to pay for the bond debt, so that's not an issue right now.
What about wastewater?
It has a specific reserve to cover its obligations. There's a bond reserve that's actually set up in wastewater for both utilities as a secondary mechanism to make sure that it pays for its own way. So that the chances of having the general fund have to kick in right now is very slim. And there would have to be some explicit actions taken by the board to go down that road.
All right, thank you.
Anyone else from the council?
Councilman
Starbuck.
Well, I don't expect us to take action tonight, but I thought we might be able to get together and maybe give staff some questions and a little guidance here. I have questions, and these aren't new questions. Purchasing the land versus the eternal lease. I really am curious if we can buy the property. What is the difference in cost on this project if we buy it? Is it for sale, or is there other property that's suitable for sale other than committing us to a lifelong payment to the airport? Next thing I have is size and cost of the station is scary. You know, station 2 currently is 2,555 feet. Our proposed station is over 23,000. It's a huge growth. It's immense. I mean, I understand that we need to replace station 2, but all of a sudden we're replacing it times 12, and it's a little bit overwhelming, especially when you're looking at $400 a square foot on this. I understand apparatus bays that hold expensive equipment, where firefighters sleep, kitchen, areas like this. These have to be built to a spec and a standard. But admin, a workshop, a gym, and these at $400 a square foot just seems a little bit on the expensive side, where I think we could do something a little different than that. I'm not real big on the EOC over there, but I see a solution for dispatch in this. I don't know if it would work or not, but I really don't want to pump the money into a dispatch or into an EOC when our biggest problem, I understand, in public safety currently is our dispatch center. So there may be a little bit of movement in that we could do something. We all of us sitting up here continually forget that over a year ago, the police chief said, right where you are, and gave us a needs assessment. $8-10 million at that time came out for basic, I'm going to consider it basic needs. This isn't a new station. This was evidence room and dispatch and some other things. If we commit to this project in its entirety, it will never allow us to move forward in the next few years for what the police need, and we need to think of that. The future maintenance on this station, if it was to build out at the full 23,000 square foot, I'm not sure what the cost is, but there's got to be maintenance down the road and an ability to save to do that maintenance, and I just haven't got that answer yet. The retrofit on Station 1 is another one of my concerns. You told us that it was, you know, roughly $3.5 million, but there's grants available, but I just feel as though we might want to have the money available to do Station 1 if we can't get the grant. There's the old proverbial Lompoc problem of we've got something new and cool, but what do we do with the old one? And what are we going to do with old Station 2? I mean, we've got a new pool, we have an old pool, you know, we're going to have an old station. I'd still like to look at the budget. We passed this budget. We haven't really heard anything about the budget. I really want to tell you that, you know, the rollover from the last budget, how are we doing on this budget, is very important on how our money stream is going in the city. And then, obviously, I'd like a pedigree on where is this money coming from. It's, you know, Joe McGuire, you know, show me the money. I'm really curious as to how we're going to come up with all this money and what funds and how. So these are my kind of issues on this.
Councilmember Vega.
I'd have to concur with Councilman Starbuck here on a couple of concerns that I have. I think it's not about the fire station. I think it's mostly the purchase of the land would be key with me, one thing, versus the lease. I think we should take a hard look at that, regardless of the direction we're going, because that could change a couple people's minds here. Also, the phasing of the EOC, I understand with phasing in, sometimes it never gets completed. I get it, but I like his idea here about looking at other areas. Or if the EOC is phased in, what is the cost savings to that, Chief? You know, if we do it without the EOC, and say we give it 5 years to do this, I mean, with some sort of a schedule. Again, we're giving staff some sort of a directive here so we can do a little homework here, because that's what I've been requested to do. Instead of coming over here and beating you up, so to speak, you've done your homework. I appreciate it, you know, and I thank you. But I do think that maybe some of the other uses need to be explained on the EOC for the public, for us. I understand you guys understand what you guys do with it. But again, if dispatch or something else was a viable option, let's look at a couple of options so that people out there aren't just going to think it's going to be just a ghost town that we use, you know, once a month or for emergencies, you know, at a cost that maybe can be justified on some sort of a schedule, okay? I mean, to get the station, I think, would be key. But I think to own the land is also prudent.
Okay. Councilmember Humdahl, you could make your motion, but from the discussion, I'm just gonna make. This is just a comment. I'm not. Later, you can make your motion, but from the discussion here, I don't know if we've got the votes. But what I suggest from Councilmember Mosby, Councilmember Starbuck, Councilmember Vega, y'all say you have additional questions you don't have answers for. I think that now's the time to present these questions to staff so we can get some answers for you. And then make some recommendations on what you would like to see. If this isn't what you want, this is what what you think we can afford, what we need. I think some recommendations on what you feel we do need, what we can afford, and where we can move, what we can move forward with. Because right now we're just having meeting after meeting and not doing anything. Mm-hmm. Councilmember Vega.
Chief and Mr. Wilkie and staff, I'd like to just see if I was clear enough in my presentation of where I think I'd like to see us go, okay? And see if we can come back with some numbers on cost to clarify a couple things as far as with or without the EOC.
I have those numbers.
If you have that, that's great. But also, let's not skirt the issue of whether we can or can't purchase the property or not. I think that's a viable option.
And that's, I defer to the city manager on that question, but I do have the numbers on with and without. We've gone over them a few times.
Yeah, those what? You know, yeah. Okay, he has those numbers right now.
The EOC package, the most of the cost of the EOC package is the communications room. And Councilmember Starbuck, you mentioned dispatch. The communications room is designed to support EOC communications. In essence, it is a fully functioning backup to the dispatch. So it has to be designed that way if it's going to be fully function. That's a majority of the cost. The rooms are all multi-use. And the EOC itself is the training room, which has been recommended over and over again. But the big cost for the EOC is going to be communications and the stuff that you keep in the closets. If you roll the EOC out and you wall off that future space that's been discussed for additional firefighters, you still come in at 13.4. And so depending on how far down the road you push the tenant improvements, it can escalate quite quickly because you lose your economy of scale. And we don't know, I've been told, variables from 3 to 5% as far as that we can build in for increases every year. But the future build out of the TI for the fire station, if you wall everything off, all the admin space, the additional bunk rooms, that is $1.282 million. And then the future TI for the EOC would be $642,000. So phasing it seems somewhat attractive, but if we don't build the box, we have to go back to complete design. So I've got that, you know, we've gone over it a few times. We've also gone over the projected cost of a multi-company station without admin, without the EOC, and that comes in right at about 10 to 11 million. So those were some of the alternatives that we showed you in a markup a few months ago, but the other piece to that is what do you do with administration? And when do you do that, and how do you fund that? So that's the future stuff kind of broken down, and the city manager probably has some weigh-in on the land.
Thank you. First of all, we did talk with the FAA. We have more conversations we'd have the succinct language about the purchase. But I would say, based upon my earlier in my career dealings with the FAA on a land purchase, I was involved in one. We did make that happen. In this case, with an appraisal of about $750,000 for the value of the land, assuming they're good with that, I think that's probably about where you could expect that the size of the check we'd have to send back to the FAA to accomplish a purchase. So I believe it's viable, but it's going to take a process of time to work that out and get that assurance, because we operate at their pace, not ours. A lot of other questions. I can respond to some of the other questions as well, but I don't know if you're looking for extemporaneous responses to your questions now, or if you'd like to formalize this more is it sounds like some of the questions we're asking I've heard before and I thought we had answered before. Maybe we need to memorialize this in a different way. Maybe we can get your either your questions in writing, or I can clarify your questions and we'll put them into writing and come up with the responses, and we can report back in a council meeting. We have a definite need. One of the general questions I'd say, we need a fire station, and you all have at one point or another indicated your willingness to support a fire station. Sounds like some of this is over some other issues about the admin space. Whether we put it here or someplace else, that's part of my list of things I've got to, that we have to come up with a solution for, one way or the other. Same thing's true for the EOC. The EOC we have is inadequate. We made it work during the Megalito fire. Wow, I wish I could describe that activity. In fact, if you'll indulge me for just a few seconds, picture a room that's maybe about the size of this section of chairs plus maybe the aisles. And we probably had 20 to 25 people in and out of their working command center. We had inadequate communications. We were working off of a lot of radio and telephone. We didn't have direct internet access even at all times because of the walls that exist. So we were doing some tricky things to try to get that information. This is both our getting information into the command center and our trying to push information out to both you and the community becomes quite challenging, not to mention the interactive communications that have to go on between the troops that are out in the field fighting the fire in that case, or fighting whatever the devastation is at the time, and the incident and the command center that's going on. In this case, we had an incident command center out in the field and a command center here, and communications were challenged quite a bit and limited. We were relying on needing some graphical information about the area we were combating, and again, because of the lack of communication even between this building and that one, we had some of our GIS personnel literally running back and forth. We tell them what maps we need and go back and forth. These are things that would be resolved. Thankfully, we had a successful battle there, but we were falling all over each other literally in this room trying to make this happen to save homes and save lives. So we have to resolve that issue again, one way or the other. We pay for it one way or the other. Yes, we also have, I recognize we have a lot of other needs in a lot of other areas. I saw that as I came here and interviewed with some of you. It didn't scare me away. I recognized how we eat an elephant is one bite at a time. But I know that to conquer the things we have to do, we do have to take those bites. We have to move ahead. We have to move forward. If we continue to not take action because we've got a lot of other bites that need to be done, we're never going to eat the problem. So I don't know how you want to proceed forward. I'd love to move forward, and I'd love to give you whatever answers that you have questions for. I'd just like to find if we can get to some formalized and succinct manner to be able to inventory all of your questions and provide you both written and verbal responses. It just seems to me we're going to have a better record and more likely to move forward if we can go in that fashion, because it seems what we've been doing, we keep bouncing back and forth. We think we've answered things. They keep getting asked. We have people that have very good, want to understand the concepts, and these are very good questions that you've had. Very important concepts to grasp the financial planning. We laid out, Mr. Wilke and I laid out how the financial payments would work and where the money's coming from. If that wasn't clear, we need to do it again, and we'll find a different way to do that. But we are confident in our ability to do the project that was presented. We've gone over it to make sure that this isn't something other than what meeting our needs and doing it in a manner that meets the industry standard and satisfying our current and future needs. None of this was done with the idea that we're just out wildly spending. There was a lot of planning that went involved in that and a lot of surety checks that we did before it came to you. So in the interest of trying to move forward, I just hope perhaps we can formalize this process, get to where we've satisfactorily responded to your good questions and concerns, and be able to make some decision to move it forward.
Councilmember Mosby.
Chief, I don't mean to put you on the spot. I did ask you this question before about using the council chambers for an EOC. Can you explain why that's not an option?
It would not be my recommendation. This building was built pre the latest earthquake standards. This building, because it's a city hall, not a police station, not a fire station, was not built to essential services standards. So it's constructed more like an office building. Now, this room in particular causes me great concern, and it's because of the roof structure. And in the event of the magnitude earthquake that we engineer for, there's no doubt in my mind that a lot of that is going to be on the floor. The other, if it's not on the floor, you're still going to need a place to meet. And an EOC is locked down. It is rapid pace, it is totally controlled, and this is not conducive to doing it all.
Does the city of Solvang, they use their council chambers though, correct?
Some cities choose to use their council chambers, Mr. City Manager.
If I could, first of all, I believe what you had said also is one of the biggest expenses has to do with getting the place technologically wired. And so we'd face the same expense we have here as we would any location we set this up. Secondly, I'm not familiar with Solvang in particular, but I know most locations choose strategically to not place their EOC at their center of government, and that's just a matter of risk management.
Or above police stations?
No, they do. A number of them use police stations. I was in Tracy. That's where it was located, a police station. In Fresno, it's located at a fire station, at fire headquarters. I imagine if you went around, they're at either police stations, fire stations, or unique bunker locations. Pretty seldom is it at the place where your head of government is. And like I say, that's for
Santa Maria's. Is at an old grade school cafeteria.
So. It is, and in talking with the deputy chief, that's a conscious decision they made to put it in an existing non-conforming building.
Right.
And that is, those are conscious decisions. It's a very valid question. There are cities that have, from a risk management perspective, made that decision. My recommendation as the person who's charged with preparedness is that would not be in the best interest of the city.
Okay, the next thing, I want to use a little latitude here and use a little logic as well in I guess probably the biggest problem I'm having is swallowing and having the people of today pay for 50 years from now. And that's in design, you know, it's a beautiful station. I don't want to, you know, say that and I don't want to look like I'm coming in after you for your work, because I know you have awesome work ethics and you've done your due diligence. Whenever I asked you a question, usually you had it, you know, more than answered for me. But I don't want to look like I'm attacking you. I'm digging deep in here and asking the tough question. And I think that's probably my biggest point of concern, is digging this deep and going this far. We have examples of that in the past. The city of Lompoc's been very good at doing that. And we've anticipated growth that hasn't come. And when you look at the 2030 plan, you look for the first decade of this century, you look what the movement's going on, you look at everything that's inside the urban limit line and our potential that we have if we build everything out and make our growth curve go to what we have. And granted, we're getting increased call-outs for whatever the reason might be without necessarily growing the town. But when I see that we have potentially housing grow out of about 30% of what we have right now, it's everything inside the urban limit line, If everything was built out at the Bailey Corridor, if everything was built out internally up on the hill and stuff, and it, when I analyze the numbers and I see what we have, and it seems like I would like to see the curve go to meet the station that you have. I'd like to see it go faster. And it just seems like such a big bite, and that's what I'm having the difficulty swallowing, is that it just seems so much more so. Well, I did tour stations in Santa Maria. I have probably looked at no less than 50 stations. I've gone online, analyze them, look at the square footage, population size, number of stations per community, and I keep coming up with a question and putting logic together that I think a station three on steroids that they have in Santa Maria, whether you put a couple extra bedrooms in there for, keep it on one story, because when you go two stories, it gets more expensive. Putting a three bays in there instead of two bays could meet us for 20 or 25 years, could meet our demand. And, you know, you're asking questions, you're asking statements where our positions are. I'm telling you honestly what I've analyzed and seen the position that I feel comfortable in analyzing the historic movements of Lompoc in the last 50 years, where it's gone, the roller coaster ride of increase in populations or not. And I believe that we could really meet a lot of the emergency needs and the call-outs and the demands that we have in analyzing these books and meeting that. Without the EOC, without the increase of admin, because we build all that admin, we still have all the admin room in Station 1. Granted, it's not a lot, but we still have it. And I'm saying the number one objective is to meet the emergency needs and having a station for the emergencies, not counting the EOC, the super emergency. But when I go through here and I look at the book and read it again and again and again, and it says what we need to do. It says replacement of the station is warranted. I agree. And I think everybody agrees up here. But how big of an apple are we going to be chewing on? And I believe if you know, like you said, there wasn't the discussion of a third station. And if we saw a growth potential moving out westward, you know, because we know we're limited on how far we can go north. And if we did, the only thing that we could go further than Bailey, which won't be in my lifetime that it goes further than Bailey, but if it happened, I could see a third station being warranted out there. And I just think we're looking at a curve that we've talked about in 1969 with the mole project, again in the 80s with the shuttle projects, and we're not cruising at those levels. It's been for 5 years recently talking about the Bailey Corridor annexations, and we're still only in talk mode. Lompoc is, you know, the stuff up there has been 10 years on the books. So that's where I stand, just putting it on the table.
Just a couple points of clarification, maybe more than a couple. First of all, this is our recommendation. I stand by the recommendation. 50 years. The 50-year comment has to do with how long the station will endure. I would be willing to bet money that you'll fully occupy that station in less than 10 years. A fire department, a fire EMS rescue department, which is what we are, all risk, is more than just running emergency calls. It's also being prepared to deal with the variable degrees of risk that the community presents. It's also being able to protect the economic vitality of a community. It's being able to protect the millions and millions of dollars of assessed valuation. And yes, some of that requires a standing army. And I get that. But it's no different than an insurance plan. Having a standing army, having a crew that's able to respond to incidents at Raytheon, to incidents within the new business park, to incidents in a four-story hotel, two incidents in whatever economic, positive economic development that comes into the community that may have just a little higher risk. That is also a big part of our job. And then the other piece of that is, yes, responding to those 911 calls in service to our citizens. So those are the projections that I look at. We've tried to put 50 years of durability in the station. We've gone with a 50-year metal roof. We've gone with recommendations for doors that are projected to last 25 years, where most of them only last 10. So I have said at every step of the presentation, every time I've come before council, I get it. It's a lot of money. $14 million is a lot of money. But as I look at the recommendations, as I look at what we've done, and Councilmember Mosby, maybe I should have added in the scope of work recommendations on the design of a station, but I feel that's best rested within internal design team. So I don't have a crystal ball, but I can tell you our projections have been hitting right on. So I'm sure I haven't answered all your questions, but I acknowledge it's a lot of money. I get it. I'm not blind to this.
So you've got City Manager, Councilmember Vega, and Councilmember Holmdahl.
Yeah. To the concept of, well, this is, you know, something that's been needed for a long time but been burdened to the present, absolutely. It's we've got that in a lot of concepts. A lot of the issues that we face right now that you face as a council, we face as a community. We've got needs not only in our fire service, we have it in our police department, we have it in our parks, we have it in our streets. The fire gap is the biggest one, and hence certainly why I was interested in tackling this, not to ignore the others. We've got plans in the works. We started analyzing what the police needs are. We've certainly been looking at how we can enhance parks and improve or gain some money that's becoming real elusive with improving streets. When you've got a lot to do, you tackle the biggest challenges first, and that's what we've tried to do here. One of the consequences of it being kicked down to us today is that we have to find a way to pay for this. This isn't all Monday morning quarterbacking. Some of this we would be saying on the front end, but back in 1985, if they had triggered their project work toward permanent facilities at the time that they're establishing temporary facilities, we'd have 30 years to be able to garner all or a good portion of the costs of what we're presenting. And if we had done that, if along the way they had set aside $500,000, knowing the amount now is Monday morning quarterbacking, but had we set aside the money, $500,000 along the way, then after 30 years you find yourself with $14 or $15 million. And if we presented this $14 million plan that met the community's current and future needs that have been collected by the development and growth, that for that specific need we'd gone over the same examination of square footage use and housing and the like, I think we would be pulling the trigger. We wouldn't be saying, oh, this is too much money, or that this is too nice of a place for Lompoc. We'd be saying, this is what we plan for, this is what we set the money aside for, and this is what we need to build. So the question, we shouldn't confuse what the issues are here. It's not a question of whether that's too big or too much of a station. It's what's called for and what's needed. It certainly is up to you to make a decision if you wish to build something and build something less. That's certainly your prerogative. But it's not about this being too nice or the other issues. This has to do with, well, unfortunately, money wasn't set aside for those specific reasons. And so now we find ourselves not only having to build what we need to build, but we have to find a way to pay for it. That's why we'd spent the time looking ahead and projecting with a finance plan that we felt comfortable with and felt comfortable projecting to you. At times, and I appreciate that when we've called it $14 million, we've stuck to calling it $14 million, even though the numbers need to be re-verified at this point, that if we're talking $14 million, and that I know at times we've alluded to $29 million because of trying to put in financing costs. I would also ask you in your consideration understand the difference between the $14 million and what could be that financing cost. Those are separate issues altogether. Because again, if we'd been doing what we should have been doing for 30 years, we'd just be talking $14 million. One of our unfortunate costs of, to use that cliche that we've heard a lot here about kicking the can down the road, one of our problems with kicking the can down the road is we also have this other $15 million we've got to come up with for financing costs because we didn't pay in advance and now we have to go pay it afterward. But one thing I know for sure, that if we don't take some action now, that amount, that other $15 million amount's just going to continue to grow because you still have the needs that still need to be met. And so ultimately, we need to do something at least to abate this idea and not continue to send this yet down the road again. Certainly, I hope it's not that we do nothing out of concern of doing something. I hope we can move toward doing something. And if we can't eliminate the can-kicking consequences, that at least we can minimize those. I'm looking forward to working with you. As I said, Chiefs pointed out, our recommendation stands as to what we had presented before. But certainly, we are enthusiastic about supporting anything you might support in terms of coming up with action to be able to help resolve our fire service needs going forward. So thank you very much.
Councilmember Vega.
It looks like we need a little bit of a direction here, Patrick, also to keep this thing moving forward. So my question again, with the purchase of land through the FAA process, what is the cost to move forward with something like that to find out if it's viable, regardless of the time frame, without obligating ourselves to a lease issue, so that we can move forward in like you said, getting the elephant one bite at a time. Okay.
I believe.
What would be the cost to the city, and how can we expedite that at least to get some sort of meeting of the minds to say, hey, they would be open to that. And where would the money come from for that also? Fiscally, I'd like to know if we had the money for it. Mr. Wilkie, you might know. Patrick, you may know. Where is that money going to come? Because that would be a one-time cost instead of a, I understand the other part of it, but that's not what I would be willing to support.
I expect, because such a purchase needs to be at a market rate, and we have an existing appraisal that included a site appraisal, if you will, of this particular land. They appraised all the airport property, but then prorated and did a portion for this particular almost 2.5 to 3 acres area, and it was around $750,000. We would have to be paying something along that line, say, probably expect to go a little bit higher just in case we have some other costs. As to how we expedite it, FAA moves like the FAA moves. So we are pressing them for an answer. We did get some answers early about some questions, this past week, over some questions we had about lease. For instance, we were trying to find out if we might be able to limit a lease. You know, if that was a concern that it could just grow and grow and grow, is there a way to cap the inflation growth rate on a lease? And their response was no, they weren't, they didn't think that would, that could cause the lease to not be within a market rate. So now we're still pursuing, we continue to pursue the question about could we purchase. We're trying to get them to give us, at least do we have hope, is there a process to be done. For us to be into deeper understanding and have some certainty, we'd have to be ready to pull the trigger. We have to be able to talk about exactly what our plan is. So we'll continue to ask the question, try to press them for a response. We might be lucky enough to have an answer within the next couple of weeks. Might take us several months. It depends on how far up the line we have to go to get that response. Where the money would come from, you could pull it from reserves. I wouldn't necessarily, from general fund reserves, I wouldn't necessarily recommend that. I would expect instead that based upon when the timing of the purchase would need to occur, that you would incorporate that with the balance of the finance package for whatever it is that you'd be billing. And I don't know if As to the cost and where the money comes from, Brad has a different view on that, but I would wrap it into the finance package.
I totally concur with that. That would be, if we go down that road, that would be what I would, it would make sense to put it all together.
It seems to me that reserves are going to be affected either way. Is that correct? One way or another?
Oh,
whether
yeah.
we move
yes.
forward, whatever option we have. I hear some deep breathing here and there, but I'm telling you, the reserves are being affected either way, whichever direction we choose. And you know what I'm saying is, like, what we have is we can get a consensus. I'm sure they'll give us some sort of a direction, whether that process is open or if that's what they're looking for. You know, Patrick, I'd be looking for something like that. If we can do it without any substantial cost or whatever, I'm sure you guys are great negotiators over the phone. So anyway.
I don't think there's a lot of transaction cost that's associated with that. I think it mostly comes down to the value of the land.
Councilmember Holmdahl.
Yeah, going back on the land, my understanding was that we would be purchased on a lease in 30 years. It's in your book here, the amount on that lease on that property. The thing is that the property indirectly belongs to the city of Lompoc because we brought it in with FAA funds.
Yeah, not indirectly,
but
very
directly.
Very directly.
So
it's,
the property
it's owned by
is
the
ours.
City.
And I hear too many people say, well, we should go someplace else. That means we buy land from somebody else and takes it out of the ability to develop on. And to me, that's probably the worst thing we could do, is because right now we can put it on there, we pay ourselves a lease. Any money that comes in, that we could utilize it at the airport, so we don't lose a dime out of that. Indirectly, it's probably putting some money back to the construction process. Yeah, as I look in here, we're talking different lease figures and everything else, but the property, it can be used and be utilized. I haven't heard anything that brought up to me that will change my mind from where I'm at.
Councilmember Mosby.
A question for the chief here. If a project were put together that had a station on that land that was able to be purchased from the airport with the FAA, from the FAA, whatever covenant gets released off of that, and if you had a station that was built, a three-bay station with six bedrooms, that would meet your rescue, the BC and four firefighters, and then you had, along with that, sometime you had the land set aside separate from the station for an admin building and an EOC that could sometime be forecast down the road. You see things are turning the corner and looking better. That you had the land available to build that separate from the fire station. Could that and would that meet emergency needs and needs that we primary needs? It's not going to meet 110% of what you foresee as the objective, but an objective that we need of replacing fire station two. Maybe it's a basic station. Can you see that coming? Is there any feasibility with something like that, I guess?
Is there a feasibility? Sure. There's always a feasibility. It's complete redesign. Going to one story, you eat up more of a footprint. It's one of the reasons we went to two. If we don't move the headquarters, we don't move the battalion chief. It's extremely important that the executive team remain at headquarters. Pretty simple. If you're talking about a multi-company station, which was even recommended back in the CIP, they recommended two staffed apparatus, three each. So we need to be able to put the truck company there. We need to be able to accommodate staffing for the truck company. The rescue squad is a stopgap. Right there, that's three bays. That's three bays. Before you start worrying about storing your reserve apparatus, which is one of the reasons this was designed the way it was, trying to get our reserve apparatus. And I'll tell you, the recommendation right now is we need more reserve apparatus. Standing here tonight, we have two fire engines out of service. We need an additional reserve engine. So not planning for that in the very immediate need is not something I would recommend. But anything's feasible. If you want to send us back to the drawing board, all I ask is for direction. But I will tell you, because I've talked at length with the architect, we'll have to go back to design. I think we're good on the environmental. I think we're good on the traffic. But we will have to go back to station design.
I mean, I know it's not the whole enchilada, but I think it's a significant movement in a much better direction. I'm looking for something toned down.
And I appreciate that. And so my recommendation for your consider, if you wish to give us direction to tone down, then we go back to the multi-company option that was presented months ago, had no admin, had no BC, did have the training room, because today we don't have enough meeting space to pull everybody together. And that was an option that was shared with you earlier. We will have to, once we break ground, if that's the option you go with, we should immediately start planning how we're going to accommodate the additional administrative staff.
In meeting space for, what do you need the meeting space?
Training sessions.
Can we CPR. Do any of this at the Dick DeWeese Community Center?
It is not convenient.
Not convenient.
We have to work around, you know, I've been sitting in meetings where you've requested recreation to make money on that facility. If we tie it up for every meeting, that pushes the seniors out, it pushes those money-making opportunities out. So that, I mean, every study that's been done recommends an enhanced meeting room for the new station.
And which square footage room was that? Was that the smaller one or the?
People.
That's the EOC room?
No, that's the training room that could double as an EOC. It always started as a training room.
I got you. That's the big room.
It's a 50-person training room.
All right.
Okay, we're going to open this up for public comment. You don't have anything to say? Step forward.
Mayor, council members, staff, and residents, my name is Janelle Osborne, and I'm resident of Lompoc. According to the current council's top five goals, economic development is very important. Based on projects recently approved, such as the grading begun at Hilton Garden Inn, the 40-acre industrial park at Barton and Central, soon to break ground, to the newly annexed area at the Y and the 40-plus homes to be built there, and potentially the 250 from the Tobes organization, as well as those that are being completed along Western Avenue at Bailey and Central. Businesses are beginning to trust that Lompoc welcomes and supports their investment in our community. And this is a major reason to construct the new fire station too. A city that invests in its infrastructure builds confidence in developers. A city that builds a fire station with foresight beyond the current construction and growth sends an even stronger message to investors. One that says Lompoc understands the bigger picture and the need for potential growth and looks to better manage its municipal city for all. Short-sighted, sufficient and adequate plans have hobbled Lompoc for 30 years and will continue to do so if we do not build the recommended facility. Upgrading and improving services is never inexpensive, but the staff has followed your directives and presented a very good plan. I read the staff report, which answers many of your questions. There are no new taxes created or fees on the residents. There is no new bond measure. And staff's time will not be used to oversee the construction, saving nearly $450,000. Not only will it be a new building, but the plan includes all the fixtures, furnishings, and equipment. So the day that it opens and the doors roll up, it will serve our community. It includes a new emergency operations center to replace the current inadequate and outdated multi-purpose room that is utilized. It utilizes property we currently own, and despite FAA requirements to lease the land, it is a lease to ourselves with the potential to ability to purchase it from the FAA. While some of you profess that it can be done for $3 million, there is a reality check. As Chief said, Goleta just released its plan for a 3-bay fire station, and the price tag for construction was nearly $8 million without any of those FF&Es, and nearly $2 million to purchase the property. I ask the council to provide direction to staff that moves this project forward. Do so before developers decide we do not want to provide the best infrastructure and best public services possible to both our residents and businesses, causing them to rethink the decision to invest in Lompoc. Thank you.
Thank you. Next. Okay, seeing no one rise, we're going to close public comment, bring it back to the council. Okay, what's the preference of the council? Councilmember Starbuck.
You know, I'd like to address the city manager's concerns here. I think that maybe something in writing, a little bit of a formal, you know, okay, you and, you know, Mr. Wilkie had presented some finance numbers, but they weren't the depth of numbers for a project of this scope. I think that there would, I didn't remember them being that. And, you know, just some of the other just basic questions here, they should be addressed. And I think we should do it in maybe a more formal way and just put it on an agenda once it's together.
Anyone else?
Could I have some clarification on that? Well, how do we want to make sure we get this into writing? Do you want to submit? Is it council's desire to submit their questions in writing to staff so that we can turn around and make sure we've got them answered? Or how do you want to proceed with
it? I would absolutely be willing to do that with you.
Thank you.
Anyone else from the council?
Dirk, could you explain again exactly what you want?
Well, I 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 8 pretty basic questions, you know, and I think that there's a few other questions, you know, here, and once, you know, these were answered, I think we would all be on the same page, and then we can move forward and decide what we're going to do here. Downsize the station, build this station, how we're going to fund it, where's the money, et cetera, et cetera.
Patrick, how soon could you come back and have that information?
Probably 2 meetings out, depending on how quickly. I imagine we can get together soon, so.
Okay, I'd like to make the motion that we consider staff recommendation to have direct continue to move forward, but I know there's not 3 votes here, and I'm not going to waste our time on that. But what I want to encourage, from what I'm understanding, we have concerns about the land, a lease versus a purchase. I think we need to address this and get this all out of the way. You know, so either to satisfy the members of the council that are concerned about that, or, you know, at least we know all the information. If we can't purchase the land, if we can't, I know it's going to take time with the FAA, but maybe there's another piece of land we want to go. If that's an issue with this council, it's a lease versus a purchase. The other concern that I'm hearing is that the size of the facility, a facility possibly without the multi-purpose room, the ELC and the office space, going to more of a multi-company station. So I think, come back to us with that option. I believe, is that what I'm hearing? Come back to us with, I'm sorry, City Attorney.
Mr. Mayor, maybe I could make a suggestion. I think I've been involved with this long enough to know that when questions are summarized from the dais and we then think we're answering those questions, they're not getting answered. So my recommendation would be that each council person who has questions by this Friday, if that timing is going to be good enough, we'll have to think about the timing, by this Friday, submit those questions to the city manager. And then the city manager and the fire chief and whoever else on staff, 2 meetings from now, will present the answer to those questions. Is that something that?
Yeah.
I think that kind of hits the nail on the head of what we're what I was asking for. Thanks. Yep.
Thank you. That's actually my third point, but that's good. No, it's okay. Good. So
that'd be my motion.
Okay, so let me finish this. Okay. So we are each individually going to submit our list of questions in writing to city staff, city administrator, city manager, to you?
Yes, and I'm, as I had mentioned to you in email, I'll be out of office, but you can certainly get those to my assistant, and she'll get those to me.
Okay. So if we can get those by Friday of this week, so we can get the answers back to us in 2 weeks at the next council meeting. Councilor Humdahl.
Well, that was going to be my motion, is that have everything in by Friday, and then we'll have a meeting in 2 weeks from now. And we can't keep putting it off and kicking it down the road because it's going to keep costing us more money.
Not a meeting in 2 weeks.
Two meetings from now. So that instead of keep moving it on down, and that's my motion.
Okay, I don't think we need a motion for that. It's just direction to the staff. So, Councilor Vega.
I'd like to see us all at least come together a little bit as a meeting of the minds, that as we eat the elephant one bite at a time, I think the common goal here is fire station. What size, what the needs are, we're trying to break it down to where we feel that we're being fiscally responsible to this city. I don't think that we should, whether we lease or we buy, that's one thing, but there's we do need to figure that out, okay? I think that the main purpose here is, do we want the station? Can we afford it? Are we being fiscally prudent here? Is why we're up here? So I wanted to make that comment.
Okay, good. Okay, anything else? Okay. City Clerk,
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Chief. City Clerk, any written communications?
Nothing.
Okay. Oral communications, this is your last opportunity to speak to us on anything you wish to. Seeing no one rise, we're going to close oral communication, bring back to the council for council requests, comments, and meeting reports. We'll start with Councilmember Vega.
I have nothing to report. Thank you.
Councilmember
Humdahl. Yeah, I think we had a good meeting with the sign ordinance. They're moving right along. I was real pleased to see the quality of questions and such that are moving on. The other thing I wanted to do is thank the city departments who cleaned the town up so well that when the rain went through very quickly on Sunday, there wasn't a whole lot of puddles, and there wasn't too many trees down, very few. If they were, they were on the owner's property, not on the city property. So I want to thank them. They did an excellent job of having everything ready for the amount of rain we had. I had an inch at the house that morning, so.
Okay, Councilmember Mosby.
I've got one comment I'd like to make. In the future, when we're up here going over and going through items of concern as we had tonight, the comment keeps being made about kicking a can down the road. And if we're kicking a can down the road, why are we discussing it now? We're not discussing these things, to kick them down the road. We are trying to get through, and we're trying to solve all our problems. And this council's up here has dug in deep. We've trying to fix a computer system in council here in City Hall that's been kicked down the road for a number of years. And I think this council is doing a good job of asking the tough questions. The city manager's, he's bringing things forward that haven't been brought forward for decades. So we're not kicking the can down the road. We're trying to ask the tough questions and to be transparent. And I would just appreciate people stop saying that we're kicking down the road. If we're kicking down the road, we wouldn't even be discussing these items. And we are discussing it, and we're trying to get and do our due diligence, which is what we're up here for, to do our due diligence. So in the future, if something's been kicked down the road, can down the road, bring in a new item that has been kicked down the road from previous councils. But if we're working on something, could you guys just refrain from saying we're kicking it down the road? Because we're not. We're trying to resolve issues. We're trying to ask the right questions.
Thank you. Councilmember Starbuck.
No reports.
Okay. The 20th and 21st, I was in Sacramento for an NCPA meeting. I drove my own car, but I was reimbursed to the city for hotel and mileage. And then on the 28th, myself and Mr. Wilkie, we attended an award ceremony in Santa Barbara. Our purchasing department received a national award for their purchasing expertise, complying with all the regulations that are involved with purchasing and saving our city a whole bunch of money. So this was a award that they've received, I believe I heard, something like 19 times in the past, something like 19 or 20 times. So they received it again this year. And I'd like to make a couple council requests. The first one, we've just a little bit discussed it. We have an issue with the push carts. Councilmember Starbuck says there's three different ordinances that affect the push carts. So I'd like to make a council request that we bring this issue back and try to get that addressed one way or the other as to how we can address the push carts in our city, not just the downtown Old Town area, but in the city.
Absolutely.
I need a third.
Yeah, oh, definitely. Yes, definitely.
Okay. And then the second council request I have, a couple weeks ago we talked about our general plan, our zoning, and we as a council decided that we wanted to have the sign, our ordinance, have some priority on that, have that go forward concurrently with the rest of the zoning. We didn't know at that time when we made that recommendation to have it as a priority that there was a Supreme Court decision that severely affects our ability, not our ability, but severely affects our the sign ordinance in California. So what I would like to recommend is that we bring it back, discuss all these issues, and see if we really want to continue having our Planning Commission and City Council keep it going concurrently as a priority. There's some issues with it. So it's still going to go forward right now for the next couple weeks or so, but I'd like to bring it back for discussion so we can discuss it fully as the consequences of making it a priority. So
I heard about this, and I will give you a second on that, but it's not going to be any kind of a change in our zoning ordinance with the consultant, is it? It would just be work that all of a sudden we stop at this point because of, and we would move on with other things that basically accelerate the whole zoning ordinance?
Well, it would depend on what direction the council gave us.
Yeah,
we are proceeding with the sign ordinance and are scheduling a second workshop at this point, so okay. The council would like to discuss it again, the priority.
Yeah, and we're not giving any direction right now.
No, I understand
right now,
that. So. Just so you know, we are working through. We're very aware of that Supreme Court decision, and we are working with our city attorney and the consultant to work through our process.
Okay. So I just need, if you wanted to come back, I need a third on this.
I'll give you a third.
Okay, so just bring back for discussion to make sure that the council fully understands what we're doing if we make it a priority. Okay, that being it, this meeting is adjourned to the next city council meeting. Next joint meeting with the Lompoc Utility Commission at 5:30 p.m. on February 16th. Good night.